at Justice, then we start there.
Yeah, sure. So Aaron actually recommended me to Home Depot. We started agency side, doing client marketing. So kind of across the board, managing clients, wound up doing inbound marketing for the agency, and kind of had a really kind of crisis management PR background. So which will come up in a moment. Aaron recommended me as a perfect fit for Home Depot. So came, joined Home Depot about 5 years ago as a part of a larger social build-out. At the time, we had 5 people. We had 1 person on customer care responding to customers. So, yeah, kind of just building things.
And, Mike, you're being a little humble now. I mean, you really launched the organic social strategy at Home Depot. So can you talk a little bit about when you first came in there, what were you dealing with, and what were the immediate things that you wanted to get going when you needed to kick off this new platform?
Sure, yeah. So, like I mentioned, it was a very small team. We weren't posting to our channels unless someone on the pay team remembered we had a Facebook and a Twitter. So it was really trying to figure out, you know, what do our customers want to hear from us? Our paid partners were really focused on telling our vendor stories, starting to build out that kind of audience marketing that we've leaned into. When I started, it was really more of a crisis comms, like, you know, how do we respond to brand-level issues? We had just come off a data breach that was a big deal, and we weren't really equipped to respond to it. So my team kind of came on board with the intention of building out customer care and, you know, leaning into those brand-level issues. But also, like, you know, we had 1 million followers, or 5 million followers on Facebook. How do we talk to the people who have chosen to follow Home Depot, get them reactivated, bring them back to .com into our, you know, our paid audience strategy? So we took about 1.5 years, just threw a lot of spaghetti at the wall. You know, we started by just repurposing any paid content, and then slowly but surely started working in influencers, kind of more custom stuff, having fun with the brand voice. And, you know, after about 1 year, we started realizing a little bit of what works, how Facebook is, you know, our audience on Facebook is different than Instagram, Twitter, Pinterest. So it was really a slow but sure evolution, and then kind of as we've gotten further down the road, it's, okay, our paid partners, our retail media plus partners, they have their audiences. We obviously can't target, you know, but we can fill in the gaps. We can build the brand love. You know, we have a new CMO who's very brand forward. How do we build out our influencers? How do we talk directly to customers? How do we, you know, go find them rather than waiting for them to come to us? So, yeah, it's been a slow but sure evolution.
There's going to be a lot to click into just in that quick introduction.
Yeah.
So I love the aspect that you started with customer care. Right, and that's such an area that is like the not sexy part of retail, right? Like customer care is hard, guys, but it's probably the most important. And so how have you really transitioned into straight customer care for social media and integrating some more of the fun, right? I mean, Home Depot has a lot of great content and education, and where are you putting the fun in social media?
Yeah, and it took about 2 years for my team to be able to convince our leaders that social media is supposed to be fun. It's not just sit back, make dad jokes every once in a while. We, you know,
you do some of that.
We do have fun. My team has leaned a little too much into puns lately, but, you know, having a good time. So, yeah, it was really, again, that slow kind of focus on what are our customers telling us, you know, what stories can we tell that, you know, they want us to tell. So you mentioned holiday earlier. Halloween is obviously a big thing, which we'll talk about in a minute. Does anyone have a 12-foot skeleton, by the way?
I think we're going to have Michaels and Home Depot compete about the who's the Halloween destination up here, right?
There's room for all of us on Halloween. But, yeah, no, it was really, again, just figuring out, you know, our customers resonate with certain kinds of content. Our, you know, everything's templatized on the pay side, so we can start leaning into, you know, new platforms, new formats, test into things. So, you know, the customer care piece is always going to be there. We know we have to account for that, especially the brand level issues kind of customer care. But it's really finding those moments, you know, that customers are reacting to, doing more of what's working, and really just trying new things. So.
Have you guys done anything with cross-brand partnerships, right? Or do you kind of stay in your own lane?
Yeah, so typically, and this is part of that fun evolution, you know, we've been a brand that, you know, we have fans. People talk about us. We do a lot of fun things, but we don't pat ourselves in the back very often. We tend to let those moments kind of go by a little bit and just let them live and breathe. But, you know, recently we've done a lot of non-endemic partnerships. So, you know, where does it make sense with State Farm to talk to our movers and how can we partner there? We had a really fun TikTok moment. You know, a woman posted a video of her going into a store. She was tired of her dating apps, so she deleted them and just went to the lumber aisle and looked lost until, you know, someone came up to them.
Did she get a date?
I believe so, yeah. So that started a little trend that, like, you know, we didn't feel safe immediately leaning into, you know, we don't want to reinforce gender norms with our customers. But another brand that rhymes with Sephora, sorry, Liz, they had seen a similar trend where men were going to the makeup aisle and, like, did a little cross-brand partnership to use, like, their bag and our bucket with, like, the, you know, the coffee face filters, just, like, you know, little things like that where normally with those would not happen. But
so is there going to be a Home Depot dating app in the future?
You know, I think we'll let people find love in the aisles on their own.
Okay, well, how about at least a candle that smells like your lumber aisle? Because I don't know about you guys, but I could just go in there and breathe that sawdust. It smells so good.
Man, yeah, I've been trying to get a lumber scented or garden center scented candle for 4 years, and no one will let me make it. So, yes, I'll put this video online.
All right, perfect, perfect. So let's talk about platforms for a second, right? It feels like there is a new social media platform every 14 seconds, right? And it's really hard to keep up. You have to be on all of them. Do you need to be on all of them? Do you have a preference over one of them? How are you kind of thinking about your holistic brand strategy when you have so many platforms at play?
Yeah, so, you know, we try to chase them down where we can. But at the end of the day, if our customer's there, we eventually should be there. We are generally led by our media strategy. You know, if they have the pipes in place to reach our customer and we can do it in a brand safe way, you know, that kind of will help that cause. But it took about 18 months to convince our VP and our CMO that we should be on TikTok, you know, for multiple reasons. But, you know, from a brand perspective, we're not typically very funny or, like, musical or so. And it's, you know, it's tough work to make that kind of content. So, you know, Threads felt like a pretty easy win just because it was integrated with Instagram. It felt like Twitter, so there's a lot of strategic alignment. But right now it's really just brand managers forgetting they have a brand voice for the most part. So, you know, we kind of pick and choose our moments, but, you know, we're on everything that's applicable. For my team, it's, you know, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Pinterest, YouTube. We've looked at Snapchat. We have a light Reddit presence, and then, you know, Threads and TikTok. Personally, for all of its sins, my favorite is Twitter. I hope it's still around in a year. You know, every platform has...
So every platform has its purpose for you, right? And is Twitter primarily still the dad jokes and memes, or is that customer care? How are you guys thinking about that?
Yeah, so Twitter is that fire hose of content. It's where people are having real-time conversations. You know, it's not a huge revenue driver for us, but it's, you know, we have a college, you know, college game day. It's one of our huge sponsorships, so we're present there during college football season. It's massive for, you know, spotting brand-level issues. It's the best platform for social listening. Our care team is there. Facebook, we know, is, you know, a bit of our older customer. They're on there all day. It's a huge revenue driver. Pinterest, you know, it does pretty well for us. But we know it drives a huge, you know, in-store cart. YouTube, we have a gigantic library of content that really kind of got us through the pandemic. We were ready for the customer when they were doing projects at home. So, yeah, it's really just that kind of putting the pieces in place and, you know, waiting for each platform to catch up to it.
And have you guys done anything with, you know, rewarding these audiences who follow you, right? Like, they're some of your most loyal customers. So as we talk later this afternoon about how we market without promotions or coupons or discounts, have you all done anything with early access or, you know, leaked content or product exclusivity that are going to be specific to each of these channels?
Yeah, so Halloween is another great example. So I think it was 2020, we released that gigantic skeleton, and I'm sure our merchant team thought it was going to be a great success. We were a little taken aback by how much people loved it. And over time, we've really shifted that, you know, speaking of the holiday data, we know that people start planning for holiday and Halloween in July. So we've started launching our Halloween and holiday assortment in July. But as, you know, we kind of watched the social landscape, that giant skeleton grew a huge fan base. And there are multiple private Facebook groups that are dedicated to Halloween and the giant skeleton. And so we've started leaking, you know, information about it, teasing new content. We invited them out to the media launch for our assortment, you know, the last 2 years. So it's really, again, just like finding those super fans, leaning into them. A couple people have mentioned our kids' workshops the first Saturday of every month, and there's a huge community around that. So, you know, trying to find those opportunities to surprise and delight people where our media strategy is getting product out there, but we can lean in with the brand.
Now, do you have the giant skeleton?
No, my fiance would not let me get one. I do have a 12-foot levitating witch, though.
Oh, okay. So there was a compromise.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, okay.
Like, that's fine.
And that's the key to a healthy marriage, guys. Relationship advice from Home Depot.
I think she knew I was going to keep it up all year. So,
we talked a little bit about audiences across each of these platforms, right? And I think you guys own the boomer market, right? I don't know if you guys saw the meme that was coming up. It's like, by the time you're 35, you have, like, a blood relationship with either Lowe's or Home Depot, and it's, like, one way or the other, right? Obviously, everyone in here is Home Depot. But how are you guys thinking about your strategy with the younger audiences, with Gen Zs, with millennials? Is that an emerging market for you guys? Do you have to talk about them differently?
Yeah, so, great question. Obviously, our boomer market is still our number one customer. They obviously own a significant portion of the homes in the country. A lot of still wealth concentrated, so they still are the driver of our business to a certain degree, but they also have, 95% brand affinity with us, where, the millennial generation, it's about 65. Gen Z, it's even, way lower. So, we are really thinking about that. Turns out millennials didn't kill every industry, including home improvement. So they are our next customer. So, thinking about TikTok, for instance, not a platform we're super comfortable with. We're learning it very quickly. But the opportunity is to be more proactive. So rather than, on YouTube, we have that huge body of content. We were waiting for someone to come in the moment. If their toilet broke, they need to fix it. They come to Home Depot, find the video. On TikTok, it's someone who went to a store and they were embarrassed to ask an associate, what is a screw gun? Or where do I find the screw guns? It's like, do you mean a drill? And she ran out of the store embarrassed. So that's an opportunity where we, using the orange apron, one of our associates, to build that project and product authority by assuring that person that it's okay. Not everyone knows what a drill is or how to use it or what projects the drill is right for or an impact driver. So it's a finding that new way of delivering, what we always have, that brand promise of being real, authentic, genuine, and helpful. So it's really just really changing how we find our customer rather than, again, waiting for them to come back.
So there's an education component, there's an assurance component, right? I mean, and also are these millennials, Gen Zers, are they finding that they're just not buying houses, so they're not into it? Is it more small project-based versus I'm going to take down this entire drywall by myself?
Right. It's a mix, especially with the millennial customer. They are now buying homes, but even in small spaces and renting, especially during the pandemic, people were stuck at home and needed something to do. So whether it was going to Michael's and finding a new hobby or improving their home or how do I hang a shelf for the first time, that was really the driver of the business. So it's a really across the board of, using influencers, how do we educate, how do we educate, using one of our associates. So, it's kind of across the board, whether it's a small project, big project, or how do I become a pro? That's, obviously 50% of our business. And, we've made steps to educate that next and investments in educating the next generation of pro and educating them and then connecting them with current pros for jobs. So.
As you think about cross-brand partnerships, I know the Arby's person, our persona, really over-indexes in Home Depot pros. So maybe we can talk about something there, too.
Yeah. Roast beef and a table saw?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. Or a Jamocha steak, maybe something there?
Yeah.
Yeah. You talked about your YouTube content, right? You mentioned in our prep that you had something 1,500 YouTube videos, right? That is a lot of content. And that's an active search platform. So people are actively going in there. They're probably mid-project. How do I do this? How are you repurposing that content? Are you repurposing, right? Everyone wants to figure out how do we extend the longevity of this one asset we create. How are you doing that and personalizing it across all these channels?
Yeah. I think how-to is a perfect example of, again, where you want to own that authority for each project. It worked out very well for us. We had that huge content or library of content going into the pandemic. We really won on search, both from YouTube and through our website. But now, as things are changing, we do want to extend that. So a good way to think about it is, this is a weird Home Depot factoid, but for Black Friday, we have to plan our organic content through the month. We have to prep for our sales, but we also know, weirdly enough, that the Saturday after Thanksgiving is the number one day to replace a toilet in America for reasons unknown. So we're going to also have that how to replace your toilet guide, through the month. So
many fun facts we've learned this morning.
Got a bunch of them. It's really, how do we pair that product knowledge and project knowledge with these sales opportunities? So, the toilet guide is one thing, but also refrigerator buying guide or just inspiration using influencers. So it's kind of that pairing, building up to a commerce moment using that how-to knowledge.
And so are you guys also now planning for the holiday right now, right? I mean, shoppers start in July. I know for us, Dunkin' Donuts is one of our brands. Pumpkin Spice launched last week. I'm like, it's 95 degrees outside. I don't want pumpkin, but I guess this is where we're at. Are you already thinking about holiday?
We're already thinking about spring, but yes. We're prepping into that. Again, all of our campaigns come together. We work very closely in parallel with our paid partners, with our influencer teams. So, again, it's where do we find the organic opportunities to build on the product, sales stuff that our paid team is doing that we can kind of build that brand in parallel. So, yeah, we're planning through holiday right now.
All right. So what about last things, right? Final thoughts. What's next for Home Depot? Are there new things that you're working on, what's keeping you up at night when it relates to organic social media and the rest of your strategy?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, the big thing is, as the platforms change and keep changing, everyone wants to be TikTok, so our reach on Instagram has dropped about 50% year over year. So it's really, how do we continue to chase our customer, provide the right content format, so, you know, and also testing for our paid partners, you know, content has to work harder for them as well. Instagram was a great example for us last year. We ran a full month of Reels tests that we all shot in-house with smartphones, very down and dirty, saw 30% increase in impressions and clicks, and that those insights drove to our paid team for, you know, just new content insights. So
you work really closely with your paid team.
We have, yeah, especially we have a new CMO who's very focused on the brand and, you know, how can we build content that can be repurposed for our paid teams or just boosted from our channels. But, you know, we know a lot about that customer touch point. What are they telling us? So, it's easy for media people to stay disconnected from the customer and just focus on, ROAS and incrementality. But we know what the customers are telling us. We have the creative insights. You know, we know what platforms are talking about what. So, yeah, we are in lockstep with them.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. I think we have time for some Q&A.
Yes, we do.
Yes, excellent.
Anyone have a question for these guys?
Or for?
No, it's kind of Marcus.
Good morning, it's Marcus Roundtree from Nordstrom. First, thanks for bringing the energy. First panel in the morning. Mike, I got a lot of questions about replacing the toilet, but I'll take that offline. But the question for you, Mike, how do you measure success? You talked about all the different platforms you're on. Is it watch time on YouTube? Like, how do you, across the various platforms, how does Home Depot know they're winning in social?
Yeah, it all comes down to which platform we're on. My team, you know, we mostly focus on last touch revenue and traffic. So, you know, if we're driving that traffic, we're doing great. I think we're a little bit blessed that our leaders don't necessarily care about a lot of the vanity metrics. So our follower growth, our impressions, we really focus heavily on sentiment. Are we responding to the customer, you know, in a timely manner? Is our care team, you know, having great CSAT scores? Is our content working hard enough, really? It's a mix of, you know, Pinterest, it's click-through rate, how hard is the creative working, do we need to change up our creative? We actually just ran a new test where my team had, like, really native templates that increased, like, paid clicks 50% over the marketing templates we have. So, like, it's that level of how are we doing better and what are the insights that we can drive to our partners. Mm-hmm. And also, thank you for being everyone's hype man, Marcus. You're great.
Mike, I was wondering in terms of your media mix, you know, now that you're using so much social, and is most of that earned or is it paid? And then how much does it impact your, you know, other, where you're investing otherwise? Channels?
So our mix is, you know, kind of across the board. We will chase our top, drivers, but putting a lot into paid search, obviously, especially our .com team is very focused on last touch traffic, which is an easy lever to pull for that. As we get down in to, like, the lower funnel and even upper funnel for awareness, our paid social team focuses very heavily on meta platforms. We're on Nextdoor. We're starting a little bit on Reddit. And for my team, you know, we spend probably too many calories on TikTok for my taste because it's not really a traffic driver. But, you know, we do a lot on Pinterest, just kind of earning that customer inspiration and getting them into the store to buy a full project rather than just, like, one product. Twitter, we're there just because we have to be. It's kind of a mix for our team, but we kind of are across the board on social and just growing every day.
So did you take away from the other channels, like, say, Linear or any of the CTVs, or is it basically you're just incorporating it?
I probably can't speak to that too much, just mostly on the organic side, but we are growing on CTV all the time. I think we're dialing back display a little bit from what I do know, but, yeah, we're pretty heavily invested across the board.
Anyone else?
From Media Post. How, tell us a little bit about your social listening regimens, and especially how they tie back to marketing, the ways in which you're using social listening, what you're listening for, the sorts of triggers you're looking for, but then also if you've got in place a system where you're talking to marketing and feeding back and are having an impact in what they're doing.
Yeah, so we have two levels. We use a platform called Sprinklr. Just for our everyday social media management and our customer care team, and they have pretty robust social listening. So we partner with our corporate comms team on that. It's a lot of, like, watching out for those brand level issues or just getting general volume tool called Brand Bastion, which is very focused on meta platforms and more for comment moderation and hiding harassment or profanity, which we get a lot of. But it also is a kind of creative check that if we're getting certain dynamic ads that are being like, why doesn't this link to the product, or the link broken, we can kind of spot those for the media team before they're getting, their metrics are taking a nosedive. We can help spot that. So it's a mix of, both what products are trending that we can kind of inject back into our category marketing teams, into our paid team, or being that kind of early warning system for either brand issues that we might need to pause for, or, hey, this campaign's not working for one reason or another. Or we're getting a lot of comments and questions on, hey, what is that paint color or that tile that we can kind of get more targeted creative insights back to the team.
Hi, Diane Caroli from Dish Media. We chatted a little bit about this last night, but can you share a little bit about the insights that your team is able to share for your retail media network, for the rest of the retailers in the room that have retail media networks?
Yeah, so that is honestly an area that we're ramping up to, but going back to the social listening piece, one area that we're really focused on is, with our top-tier vendors, can we provide, customized social listening reports in the Home Depot, space, and just whitelist that for them? Can we build out priority care queues? Can we look for those kind of non-endemic or endemic partnerships for our vendor partners? So it's kind of building that out and also kind of that early warning system for this isn't working, or, hey, one of our kitchen brands has a real problem with delivery, or their ice machines are breaking. So, we can kind of build out those, product-level insights, but also what the customer's saying about any particular retailer. So we're still building that out for sure, but we're definitely very focused on it, and more of a value add than actually a seller. So.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Mike. That was awesome. Thanks, Erin.
Awesome. Thanks, Mike. Appreciate
Thanks,
it.
All.